I'm Emily Actorzandi, Managing Director of Atlantic Live, and I would like to welcome everyone to the first event in a new 10-part series, We the People. Yes, We the People, as in we the people of the United States, in order to form a more perfect union, establish justice, ensure domestic and tranquility, et cetera, you know the West. The preamble to our Constitution tells the story of our beginning and our collective action. Today and in our series to follow, we will explore the notion of civitas and talk to those who are reaching across party lines to break through gridlock and bring about change by tackling the nation's biggest problems through robust debate and collective action. Before we begin, I'd like to thank our underwriter, the American Federation of Teachers, for making this 10-part series possible. And we're delighted to have AFT President Randy Weingarten here with us this morning. And I'd like to welcome her to the podium to make a few framing remarks. Randy?
So I am, I couldn't be more pleased that the Atlantic, did I get this right? Since you are so much taller than I am. Geometry at work. I can't tell you how thankful and grateful I am that the Atlantic saw an idea that we were kind of talking about and made it a reality. And so for those who don't know, I am a recovering social studies teacher. And in fact, the first lesson I remember ever teaching, meaning I remember my principal kind of coming into the room and watching me do it, and so I immediately froze, and that moment of being frozen is etched in my memory. But that lesson was about the Lockean social contract. And I believe in the Lockean social contract as much today as then. And I'm not explaining it to this audience because if you are actually here, you probably know what I'm talking about. But essentially, it is what the United States democracy rests on, which is that we together find common ground. Yes, robust debate, but in that common ground, we may cede some of our rights in order, meaning C-E-D-E, in order to seed S-E-E-D, a vibrant democracy. But for that to happen, leaders have to talk honestly and openly. There has to be a sense, not just of robust discussion, but a sense at the end of the day of a single shared nation. And that nation is not simply the responsibility of the leaders we elect. We do not outsource our power to those leaders. We share responsibility with those leaders. And frankly, the essential nature of leadership is not who can be more hyper-partisan or who can send out the best tweet. The essential nature of leadership is not just this discussion or having this discussion. It's not just robust debate, it's action. And that's really, really, really hard in a period of time of hyper-partisanship. Obstruction is easier than action. This nation was founded on finding common ground while standing our ground. Those 13 colonies were pretty different, but they found common ground while ensuring they kept their values. And so it's my honor to actually introduce Congressman Tom Cole. Now, as you could imagine, he and I disagree on a whole bunch of things policy-wide. But I am really, really grateful that he, as well as so many other Republicans, worked with Democrats in the House of Representatives on changing federal education policy in two major respects, career and tech ed, where they passed a new bill by like remarkable numbers that no one has seen in the recent past, and the ESSA bill, which President Obama, when he signed it, called a Christmas miracle. These fundamentally change education policy in this country to really focus on the things that we need most. How do we actually address children's well-being? How do we engage students in powerful learning? How do we lift up and build the capacity of our workforce? And how do we let states and localities actually do the work that in this country they were supposed to do in terms of ensuring children's success? You can find common ground while still standing your ground. And Congressman Cole is the epitome of that kind of work. And so without further ado, Congressman Cole.
Thank you, Randy. And as they come to the stage, a few housekeeping notes. Please silence your cell phones, but keep them out to join the social media conversation using the hashtag WeThePeopleATL. And we're delighted to have joining us on stage, as Randy mentioned, Congressman Tom Cole, the Republican from Oklahoma, first elected in 2002. Cole is a whip, deputy whip in the Republican caucus, and has been described, rather, as one of the sharpest minds in the House. And he's joined with the Atlantic's Washington Bureau Chief, Yoni Appelbaum. So Congressman Cole and Yoni, the floor is yours. Thank you.
So thank you all for coming to join us this morning when we thought we'd kick off a series on the smooth functioning of civic institutions and the need for effective compromise. We thought, how better to begin that than by talking to a member of the United States Congress. Actually, what I want to start with this morning is by ambushing Congressman Cole. I found we share a dark secret, which is that we both wasted our youths pursuing doctorates in history. And so this weekend, I pulled The Life and Labor in the Isle of Dogs, The Origins and Evolution of an East London Working Class Community. Congressman Cole may be the only member of the House Republican Congress to be a certifiable expert in proletarian communities. But the reason I want to look back is that I think I'll let you correct me if I'm wrong, means that you were grounded from even before you stepped out onto the public stage in careful thought about what it takes to make a community function, and a close study of difficult compromises and culture in adverse circumstances. I was struck in particular by something you wrote there, that the values that such communities encourage, cooperation, neighborliness, social egalitarianism, solidarity, and a sense of belonging, are worth preserving and encouraging in any social system, perhaps even in the United States Congress. So I was wondering if you could tell us what it was that drew you to look across the Atlantic and study that community and how that choice has informed your career.
Well, it's a generous assessment. Frankly, the Cockneys on the Isle of Dogs have preserved community a lot better than Congress of the United States has. So honestly, by accident, I'd gotten interested in British history in college. I stumbled across a book, really an anthology, a collection of a guy by the name of Charles Booth wrote a very famous late 19th century study of London. Actually, began with the guy. He was a very successful business guy, and he'd read an article that in the richest, most powerful city in the world, a quarter of the people lived in poverty, and he didn't believe it. Actually sat out on a survey of London, street by street. Actually, this ended up 17 volumes long when it was finally done. And he concluded at the end of this, yes, he was right. A quarter of the people didn't live in poverty. A third of the people lived in abject poverty. So anyway, I got fascinated by it. I won a fellowship after I graduated from college. I wanted to go to London, sort of study these kinds of communities, see what impact, honestly, the social welfare state it had on them. Did they still have the same sort of kinship and friendship networks and support systems that, again, there's a whole school of British sociology about this that sort of intertwines with history. And I thought, well, if I'm going to go to this place, I don't want to live over in the West End with a bunch of students. I want to live in the East End. And so I ended up on the Isle of Dogs, and with my wife, we had just gotten married. So, you know, it was a terrific experience, and I met a lot of Cockneys, and they sort of invited me in. They thought it was odd that there was this American graduate student. Most of these folks had gone to public school until they were 14 or something like that. There weren't any university graduates living on the Isle of Dogs. And you know, became friends and then developed a fascination with the community, and it just struck me that this is the perfect sort of case study because of the part of London where this is had come into existence during the Industrial Revolution, the beginning really with the West India Docks in the early 19th century. So anyway, you get me on the Isle of Dogs, I'll spend more time on this than you want.
Well, I think most of those who are here came for a comparative discussion of British historiography. but let me push on there. You know, you have an unusual perspective then. A lot of congressmen know their own constituencies, their own districts well. You spent years studying a very different kind of community. What did you learn about the fabric of American life by looking abroad?
Well, you know, both obviously similarities and differences. Look, if you're from a place like Oklahoma, which is historically a fairly hardscrabble kind of place and a very blue-collar kind of community and world, I mean, obviously there's enormous differences. And yet those same kinds of kinship, friendship, networks, mutual support are there as well. And so I was actually struck by how much like the Cockneys and Okies had a lot more in common than probably either one of them would have ever guessed. But again, thinking beyond numbers into human communities, that's probably the biggest thing I got from it. I mean, we make really profound decisions that disrupt communities without ever even thinking about it. And you know, that happens routinely in an urban setting and urban renewal and what's public housing going to look like and where are we going to site roads. And, you know, there's a living organism out there, a living community that all these decisions impact. And yet, you know, for most of our history, we haven't really thought very much about that. That's true here, too. I mean, we make enormously important decisions and that have incredible consequences from everything from kids on Indian reservations to kids in inner cities to, you know, what kind of opportunities people are going to have to move up the social ladder. And usually without a lot of thought. It's usually driven much more by what are the budget realities or what programs, you know, are effective in my area or do I know about. So, you know, probably history to me, you know, it just deepens your understanding of the human condition. And that's an incredibly valuable perspective when you're legislating.
So you made the unusual jump from studying the past to decades of activism shaping the present and then into the United States Congress where you shaped the future that we'll all inhabit. And what I wondered was, what was it like as a student of community, as somebody who had spent years in a variety of institutions and on the campaign trail to arrive for the first time with your own pen on Capitol Hill and try to navigate that particular institution?
Well, I had a checkered political past long before that. Look, I'd gotten involved in politics by sheer accident. My mother was very politically active, very unusual, high school educated, Native American, and yet as she traveled, because my dad was a career non-commissioned officer, she developed an interest in politics, and she decided wherever there was two parties, politics was better. And she'd grown up in a one-party Democratic Oklahoma with all the sort of typical corruption and cronyism that comes with one-party systems of either side. And so she promised if she would, if we came back to Oklahoma, she would become a Republican. So she did. And she got very active, and this is the era when Oklahoma was incredibly Democratic. And finally, after literally 15, 16 years of party work, they persuaded her to run in a no-way race for state representative. And I shouldn't say no way, but a long shot race. And I was in graduate school at the time at the University of Oklahoma, and like most graduate students, I was totally self-absorbed, and what I was doing was the only important thing in life. And so I didn't do much to help my mom in her election, even though I was at hand. And she lost very narrowly. I always tell people the worst place on the planet to be is your mother's watch party the night she loses and you haven't done much. I mean, the guilt is overwhelming. So I actually told her if she would run again, I would learn how to run a campaign, because I could see just watching this unfold, she made the classic sort of first time mistake a lot of candidates make. She tried to be the manager and the candidate too, and she was just doing too much. And I never thought she'd run, or I'd never made that promise. And literally 14, 15 months later, I was on a Fulbright in London, and she gets in touch with me and says, "I'm running. When are you coming home?" And we laughed about it because I was coming back in June of 78, I guess that was, and went down, told my professors at OU that, hey, I was teaching summer courses in European history. I'll teach the courses because I need the money, but I'm not going to do anything in my dissertation from now to November. I'm going to focus on this race. Well, that time she won, and she went on, had a wonderful career at state government. She was a three-time state House member, three-time state senator, a mayor. Very interesting figure in Oklahoma political history. But I got hooked on politics. I mean, I started running campaigns for fun, and finally somebody came and asked me to do a local race. I said, "I don't have time. I'm teaching." And the magic words, "Well, I'll pay you," came out of his mouth. And I said, "Really? Well, that's great." And started doing that, and then stumbled into politics as a political director for the state party, executive director, actually, in the 80 cycle. And then there was always another political thing and another political thing. So I really got into it much more working in the campaign combat side of this stuff, which I enjoyed a lot. I mean, you know, it's... when I was a kid, I played football, and if you've ever been in any athletic event, you know, a watch party is a lot like a locker room after a big game, win or lose. I mean, there's an incredible bonding experience that goes on between people. You've worked together for some big cause. You know, you've either been successful or you're not. You get a great deliberate outcome. So I liked that, and because I'd played football in high school and in college, and so it was like recapturing locker room competitive experience.
So this is interesting because you entered politics through campaigning, which a lot of politicians do, but that's partisan warfare. There's a win or a lose. You're not compromising with your opponent and agreeing to split the term. That there's one team celebrates in the locker room and the other gets that hangdog look in their eyes. So your mom was drawn into politics because she saw the dangers of polarization. She saw the dangers of one party dominating a particular place. At the time she went in, that was still comparatively rare outside of sort of the Deep South, which had been Democratic for a long, long time. These days, you can look across the political map, and there are precious few districts which aren't either deep red or deep blue. Does that concern you?
Greatly. Now, I always often say Oklahoma's now so Republican, it's just unbelievable. Literally, Democrats have not carried a county in Oklahoma in the last three presidential elections, even though in all three of those elections there were more registered Democrats than Republicans in the state. So, you know, clearly it's a very different Oklahoma than I got involved in the late 70s. And, you know, one-party governance, I saw this happen to my friends on the Democratic side. I used to call it the three C's. I mean, the first thing that happens in systems that are that overwhelming are complacency. Complacency electorally, but complacency in government as well. The second thing that happens is what I call crazies, because races are decided in primaries with low turnouts, and so the more extreme the views, the greater the impact. And that's true on the left or right. It's the same dynamic. And the last thing that comes is usually corruption, because, again, all the opportunists know which side to go on and where to be and where you can actually do something. So one-party systems inherently hold that kind of problem. As well as if you grow up strictly in a one-party district or one-party system, the ability to negotiate and compromise with somebody on the other side of the ideological or partisan spectrum is a habit you don't develop. And when I first got to Congress, and this has happened geographically in this country, this is not primarily, in my view, a redistricting problem. It's primarily a much deeper sorting of loyalties and residency. But when I got to Congress, we still had a Democrat in the delegation in Oklahoma. Arkansas next door was 3-1 Democrat. Kansas was 2-2. There were still Democrats in North Texas. Today, I don't have a Democrat within 200 miles of me in any direction. My delegation's all Republican. Arkansas's all Republican. Kansas is all Republican. There's no Democrats north of Dallas and Texas. Same time, you know, Connecticut, when I got here, was five representatives. Three of them are Republican. They're all five Democrats today. California was the biggest Republican delegation at 24. Today there's 15, and it's third behind Texas and Florida. So you're seeing this kind of thing happen. And you know, what happens at the Congress reflects what plays out underneath the Congress. Division doesn't start in Washington, D.C. and then radiate down. It's actually out in the country and comes to a point, in my view, in Washington, D.C. But we're a lot of members are coming here. For instance, I saw a statistic recently that the president carried the 100 largest counties in America against Mitt Romney by about 12 million votes. He lost the other 3,000 by about 7 million votes. Now, that's two very different Americas, and the polarization that creates extremely difficult to overcome.
Yeah, my colleague Ron Brownstein has written about this extensively, and there's two ways to look at this problem. One is that Congress is sort of fated to follow the kind of polarization that we're seeing with the geographic sorting. The other is that the American people will look to Congress for leadership and to find ways to bridge that divide. Are there practical steps that you can take in Congress? There's a whole genre of literature romanticizing the Georgetown cocktail parties of yore and thinking about past moments of bipartisan cooperation and mixing. Are there things that any member of Congress can do at this point to reestablish a degree of that kind of comedy or cooperative spirit, or is it something that has to come from the American people and filter up to Congress?
Well, now, there are things you can do, although this romanticized past is pretty interesting. If you're my age and you grew up in the era of Nixon, the idea that there wasn't partisan strife in the past is a little hard to accept. In the Congress, remember, civility was largely a byproduct of stability. When you knew one side was always going to be the majority, and Democrats in the House for 40 years, well, guess what? Everybody adopts the political reality in a much more competitive era where majorities can move back and forth. It's a very different ballgame than it was in the 50s and 60s. But there are things you can do. And some of them are just practical common sense. For instance, the committee that I chair, subcommittee on appropriations, Labor H, is probably the most contentious of the appropriations committees, because you know there's going to be fights over Obamacare, there's going to be fights over abortion, there's going to be fights over labor regulations. I mean, there's a whole panoply of things that the parties differ on. But my strategy when I got and the kinds of people, by the way, that go to those committees from each side are very different. On the Democratic side, this is the prized committee to be on, you know, so every one of my Democratic colleagues on this are a ranking member on another committee. In other words, they're very senior, they're very good. This is a place they want to go. On the Republican side, this is usually a place that you have to go so you could serve your time so you can get to defense or something else where you want to go. So our guys, at least traditionally, and this was true when I first went to that subcommittee, are mostly freshmen, sophomore appropriators. They're pretty new. They're just putting in their time, punching their deal, waiting for old guys like me to retire so they can steal the better committee spots. And we don't allocate appropriately to that. We're much more interested in funding defense. We aren't funding this panoply of programs in Labor H. The two commitments I got from my chairman when he asked me to do this, and look, this is the second largest pot of money after defense that we appropriate. It's $163 billion. A senior appropriator should want to do this. The fact that I'm 10th, and so that meant literally 8-9 people ahead of me chose another committee that could have had this committee, tells you where Republicans think about this. I said, when Hal Rogers asked me to do it, the chairman of Appropriations, I said, I will, of course, you're the chairman, I'll do whatever you want me to do. I thought I had a choice, though. And he said, well, you have a choice, but I would really like you to. I said, well, then my choice is to do what my chairman wants me to do. All chairmen like to hear that. And I said, but I have two requests. And he said, what's that? I said, first, give me a decent allocation. You know, my two predecessors, Jack Kingston of Georgia and Denny Rehberger, Montana, both had very low allocations. I said, I don't need as much money as the president wants, but I have to have enough where we can do something besides just cut everything. And he agreed to that. And then the second, I said, give me some really good players. So he added Mike Simpson, who's a very senior appropriator from Idaho, a Cardinal, Charlie Dent, another very, very excellent. Now I already had a core. It's like football. I have pretty good young players, but I need a couple of seasoned players. And so he gave me that. So, number one, we started off in a better place than any of my predecessors. Number two, the next practical thing was We had had almost no hearings in this committee in the preceding 4 years because it didn't have much money, it was uncomfortable, it was partisan, and so they would have 4 or 5 meetings a year, and that was it. I decided, and I had a great sit-down, my ranking member is Rosa DeLore from Connecticut, you know, and she's a very, very able legislator. You know, we sat down, I said, let's have a lot of meetings. I know where we're going to fight. I can predict it pretty early. But what if we have enough hearings, we'll find some things we agree on, I bet. And we'll make, there'll be some areas of commonality. And over the course of the hearings, I think we had 15 or 16. I mean, we had 2 or 3 times what they had had in previous years. Well, it was pretty clear everybody liked the National Institute of Health because cancer doesn't distinguish between Republicans and Democrats. There was a surprising amount of interest in early childhood education on both sides of the aisle. This would be a worthy investment. And, you know, again, there are other areas. So it's a lot easier to legislate, even when you disagree, if you can find some areas of commonality without surrendering your other positions. And the hearing process did that for us. So, you know, those are just things you do as a legislator. There's a lot of other structural changes that I would make. I mean, we've weakened leadership on the Republic. Getting rid of earmarks was a really bad decision because you're losing your ability to influence. Sometimes, honestly, you can spend millions and save billions in terms of satisfying the need of a legislator and getting them to vote for something. It's not blackmail, it's bargaining. And it's using the tools that you have to keep your own team in line. And frankly, it was also helped on the other side because the earmarks, the old formula on the Appropriations Committee is the majority party got 60% of them, the minority party got 40% of them. So you've got a member with a need that's in a different party and he comes to you and says, now this doesn't raise spending, it's all done within the budget limit, but here's a particular project in my area that's important, here's a particular cause that's doing good. It's just part of the grease that lubricated the system. Now a lot of people saw it as corruption and there was some corruption involved in it, no question. But you can reformed it and made it work right. So we've given up some tools. And we've also, you know, the kinds of people coming to Congress are somewhat different now. I think in my own state where the normal path was you spent some time in the state legislature and then you got to Congress. So you sort of had already gone to the minor leagues in terms of legislating and now you're coming up. Now, most of our, you know, a lot of our newer members have had zero previous experience in government at any level. That's particularly true on the Republican side. It's less true on the Democratic side. And it's not that they're not able and don't bring important insights, but it really, you know, it's hard to start at this level with no background in legislating whatsoever.
So I want to take this and ground it down in practicalities a little bit. The NIH example is a great one. We've talked to a lot of medical researchers who are immensely grateful not only for the bipartisan consensus on this and for the funding levels, but for the consistency and the predictability that it's restored, where now researchers can launch into their careers, can pursue subjects with some degree of confidence, again, that the funding will extend into the future. So I think it's a really great example of bipartisan cooperation. There's another issue that I know you've been active on that a lot of Americans are concerned about, which is the Zika virus and funding for it. And here's one where I think a lot of Americans look and they scratch their heads. They talk to their member of Congress who says, yes, Zika funding is absolutely a priority for us. It's a priority for them. And then they look, and month after month after month, there's absolutely no action with both sides coming up with reasons, perhaps compelling reasons, for the standoff. But can you speak a little bit to that and,
sure.
and what lessons we can learn
The issue has nothing to do with Zika. It all has to do with budgeteering and accounting and money. Look, what the administration originally requested was $1.9 billion over a 2-year period. Now, this $1.9 billion comes out of two revenue streams. One of them is Labor H, where most of it comes, and the other one is state and foreign ops. Those revenue streams in a 2-year period amount to $425 billion. Not hard to find $1.9 billion for an emergency here. And that's been the Republican position. We'll pay for it within the budget allocations that we have, not willy-nilly. What the Democrats want to do is declare it an emergency and then it doesn't count against the spending cap. So you don't have to make any tough decisions in this 400, or any more tough decisions, in this $425 billion revenue. And that's really the crux of the difference. Now, there's also a Planned Parenthood element here as well, but the real hang-up has been, do you pay for it or not? And I approach this as a guy that voted for Sandy relief. Look, there's a difference between an $80 billion emergency. You can't budget that. There's not existing revenue at that level, whether it's Katrina, whether it's Sandy. Something like this is really pretty easy to handle. And Congress actually has done something. I mean, Congress, the House, has twice passed legislation on this with hundreds of millions of dollars. A majority of the Senate supports the House bill, 53 members. So this is one where in my view, the administration and Democrats have decided, even though they're in the minority position in the House and the minority position in the Senate, that they're going to block the funding because they want to spend $2 billion on other things. They like the principle of an emergency. They like to be able to do that. I mean, emergencies are great because you don't have to pay for them. You just add it to the national credit card. And again, there's some cases where that's appropriate, but something of this size, it's really not.
So thank you for laying that out so clearly. I think what's interesting here is the difference between how Congress looks at these issues and how, say, somebody in South Beach down in Florida might look at this. They're looking and saying, Congress came up with $80 billion in response to Sandy. That wasn't a problem. All we need is $2 billion to solve a pressing public health crisis. How come Congress can't act?
Well, first of all, it was a problem to get the $80 billion.
Right.
If you go back and look at what transpired, I mean, it was a terrific struggle. And honestly, at the end of the day, we only had 49 Republicans. And on the critical amendment, which is Rodney Frelinghuysen amendment, only 38 joining with the Democrats to do that because of the focus and concern over the deficit. And again, I was one of those guys, so I thought this was a national emergency and it was too big to do any other way. This is different. And establishing the principle in this amount of money that we can handle this. Look, we do this on regular disasters all the time. We have pretty frequent tornadoes in my hometown of Moore. But we have a FEMA disaster fund. It's $10, $11 billion. We handle the normal range of disasters in a given year out of that fund. So tornadoes, not a hurricane. Looks awful on television. It is awful if you're in the path. But, you know, Sandy covers hundreds of thousands of square miles in multiple states. A tornado in Oklahoma is 17 miles long and a mile and a third wide. Now, inside, it's pretty awful. But you can handle that kind of destruction for $1 or $2 billion, and it's done pretty routinely within the existing budget. It's only when you have these great ones that you have to declare an emergency. So that's the focus. Now, at the end of the day, the other thing to recognize is there's not one thing that hasn't been done for Zika because of lack of money. Because we did have billions of dollars set aside for Ebola over a multiple year period. We may well have overestimated the cost there because even the administration in its own budget transfers $130 million, I think, out of that fund for malaria suppression. Worthy cause, nothing wrong with that, but it does tell you that even the administration thought, well, we can use this for something else now. And when we suggested we use that to the president, we said, we'll give you our guarantee that we will refill as needed this money. And you have to remember, it was Republican Congress that voted the Ebola money in the first place, and it was a Republican Congress last year that gave the president double what he asked for at NIH. He asked for $1 billion increase. He got two. Gave him more at Center for Disease Control than he asked for, and has already budgeted more this year for NIH and CDC than he requested in his own budget. So the idea that we're not willing and anxious to spend money here is quite the opposite. Now, far be it from me to suggest politics might enter into this, but it strikes me as more than coincidental that this is the biggest issue is in Florida, where we have an open United States Senate seat, several open and important congressional races, and obviously a presidential race. So there's been a lot of grandstanding on the other side, in my view, and a lot of use of this issue for political purposes. They would see it different, fair enough, but they don't have the mic right now, and I do. So
if I can get you to dip into your pocket there for the crystal ball. Do you see us finding some sort of a compromise solution?
I do. I mean, really, the money issue is basically solved. And this has been one where I would actually argue the Republicans have moved pretty consistently toward the Democrats. I mean, you know, here's the money. Let's offset it. We've provided what I would call pretty vanilla offsets in many cases. And we've told the Democrats, actually, the offsets we provided were actually provided to us by the Department of Health and Human Services and staff discussions. Well, if you had to offset, what would you prefer? Well, of course, we don't want to offset, but if we did, here's the things we think make the least impact on the other things we want to do. So that's an effort to try and work with you. It's not to try to find offsets that are offensive or hard. And in the bill that we passed, we didn't even offset every dime of it. Now, we did also appropriate for next year additional money, $390 million, in the Labor H bill for the Center for Disease Control, and close to $200 billion for USAID in the State and Foreign Ops bill. So eventually, we would have paid for most or all of this, which is one of the points of contention. But so I think at the end of the day, yes, Zika will be taken care of. And probably within the next week.
I want to open the floor to questions in a moment, but first, because this is probably the longest in months that you've talked to a reporter without them asking you about 2016, I want to sort of zoom back out and think about this moment. This has been a very contentious primary and a contentious general election. We had the Democratic nominee this week calling her opponent a recruiting sergeant for terrorism, which is quite a charge to level. We've had the Republican nominee sitting United States Senator Pocahontas, which is a remarkable thing, and as a sitting member of Congress from Chickasaw Nation, I wonder what you think about the tone of political rhetoric and discourse. Are we heading in the wrong direction this year?
Oh, no
question.
Does
it concern you?
Look, we've got two presidential candidates that are more unpopular than popular. And that's never happened before in American history. And when you're in a campaign like that, as an old campaign guy, honestly, you're not going to make your person more popular fast enough. So your aim is to make the other person, already unpopular, even more unpopular. And both sides are pursuing this kind of strategy. Both, it will have consequences for the winner on the other side of this, because the electorate is going to be, heavily divided and traumatized and angry. The losers will be. And I think on the other side of this, we still have essentially some form of divided government. No matter what happens in the United States Senate, whoever is in control of that body, it's going to be close enough that either side can block literally anything from coming to the floor. And that's what we had last year, not a single appropriations bill to the floor in the United States Senate until we reached the omnibus. So that power will exist for either side. Republicans, probably lose some seats. When you have the largest majority you've had in 88 years, it's hard to sustain that, particularly in a presidential year. We built that majority in two off-year elections, not in a presidential year. So you got to figure, we can lose some seats, but I don't think we lose the majority. So we're still there. And if you look at the polls today, while the election's pretty close, you've got to say the map works to the advantage of the Democrats. And that's not no reflection on Trump or Clinton. It just is what it is. And we've seen that in recent presidential elections. So, we're going to get to the other side of this thing. And if you don't have the ability to work across the aisle as the president or as the respective leaders in the House and the Senate, you're going to have 4 years of gridlock. And it'll be pretty devastating. So, we approach a really difficult election with very little likelihood of a certain victory. I think everybody since the Obama election in 2008 has been looking for the Holy Grail, which is, super majorities and the presidency. And that's what the president essentially had for 2 years. And he got almost everything he wanted, seriously, in that period, because he didn't need a single Republican vote to get it. And frankly, in my view, they didn't try to develop any relationships, and the Republicans didn't particularly want to develop any relationships. They knew they were a super minority, and they weren't, it was all about the next election and gaining back. So the president hasn't had that situation since then, and the next president won't have it either. And the most disappointed people in the country within the first year of the next president's inauguration will be the supporters of that president, because probably neither side is going to be able to deliver on the kind of promises that are being made out there in a pretty cavalier fashion.
Well, thank you. And I want to make sure that we give our guests a chance to ask you their own questions. There will be microphones moving around. And please speak into the microphone and tell us who you are and what you do.
Good morning. My name is John Cheeks. I'm the executive director of CRY. For most of you who don't know what it is, we are an organization who believe, and we also are writing law for the Reparations and Restitution Act for living descendants of American slaves who are black Americans. We need your support. It's needed now. And we will be voting on it next year in Washington, D.C. Are you for it?
Look, I'm Native American. If we're going to start with reparations, I got a case to make of my own. Probably not. I think the appropriate way to proceed in these cases is to try and do what can be done, and there's a considerable amount, to try and make up for what are historically unfair situations. I deal with this with Native American issues all the time. I really do. I can point out instances in our family where we were basically stripped of our land, or where my great-grandfather was forcibly marched 800 miles from Mississippi to Oklahoma. So I have a lot of sympathy for historically, discriminated against minorities. But I think the appropriate way to me, because I don't think you'll ever get that through Congress, it's just my viewpoint. You're certainly free to try. But I think the appropriate way are, to me, programs like TRIO, Gear Up, things that help first-generation college students, things like early childhood education, where you try and deal with some of the discrepancies of just, the randomness of who you happen to be born to and where you happen to be born. Those kind of things you can create political consensus around and move forward.
Thank you.
Somebody right here.
Thank you. My name is Li Yang. I think you know that our election process is really in shambles. We have unpopular candidates as nominee. On the other hand, we don't like those super PAC dark money. And actually, the people's voice are not heard. The general public, their voice are not heard. So I just wonder, it's really inexpensive if we have have a real candidate forum. Everybody can participate, including third party or even non-party at all. Because actually, people's voice is the most important. We say that we the people. But now we don't say that we the people. We are saying we are electing somebody who is not really representing the people, whether you have two party or three party. So I wonder if you can do the effort to allow people to speak, whether that's in the town hall meeting or CET or state general assembly. Mm-hmm. Currently, they don't allow people to speak. Instead, they will be retaliated. All the agencies, they are whistleblower will be retaliated. We got to improve our system in the right way.
If I may, let me focus that a little bit. You said before that you weren't convinced that redistricting was the problem. Clearly, there's a great deal of concern about the responsiveness of the political system and sentiment for reform along a variety of axes. Which are the political reforms that you see as promising for fostering an environment of cooperation and greater democratic responsiveness?
Well, look, there's again some structural opportunities, but most of all, this is not a hard system to participate in. The fact that Bernie Sanders went from a kind of obscure, not even a Democrat, independent socialist to being the challenger, and frankly, had there one of my good Democratic friends I have a lot of respect for, very shrewd observer. I'll leave him unnamed because I'm going to quote him, and I don't want to put him in a bad spot. But he told me, he said, look, Tom, he said, look who you guys nominate. He's not a Republican, and if we'd have had the same situation at the outset of our campaign, where we had 15 different candidates, Bernie Sanders would be the nominee, and he wasn't a Democrat until he was running for president. So, you know, the system actually has allowed for people to come in. And look at the funding for Senator Sanders. It's a remarkable achievement in terms of how he got funded. It's not very hard to send money to anybody you want to send money to. You just type their name in the internet and the opportunity is available. So that was a, you know, both political establishments were under tremendous assault within their own parties this time around. And people that are in those establishments need to take that in. In terms of opening up the process, I agree with you about candidate forums and town hall meetings. I do all those things, both electronically and things. But I don't find it hard for people to participate. And the problem here isn't the system. The system is actually pretty responsive over time. It does what the founders meant it to do. It's frustrating. I mean, the founders built checks and balances and three different branches because their biggest fear was concentrated power. And they saw that as the main problem. And so they've made it, I mean, if Madison could come back and look at this, he would be thrilled. He said, they can't get a damn thing done. That's exactly pretty much what he wanted. But over time, you know, again, I live in a country where I grew up in. I could travel through the South and parts of my own state, and the words there were no colored allowed. I tell that to my son now, and he looks at me like, how old are you, Dad? Was that like the Civil War? There's been amazing social change in the country. And while people worry about, and I think legitimately, economic inequality, the reality is most people live better than their parents did and better than their grandparents did. It's still the freest, most secure country in the world. So we have problems, but a lot of these problems we need to look in the mirror at. And some of them reflect, you know, the sort of schizophrenia occasionally of the American people. You know, who want a lot of things but don't want to do it. If you want to participate in politics, believe me, it isn't hard. You know, people are desperate for you to go vote. Not hard to vote in this country.
So if tomorrow you could unilaterally insert a single amendment into the United States Constitution that would fix one of our structural problems, would you leave it as it is? Is there something that we could do that would change the system?
I'm not a big believer in big constitutional amendment solutions to problems, because usually people are searching for a once and for all time solution, and I don't think there are once and for all time solutions. The biggest, most important thing is participation by people, the willingness to be, and to understand that progress by its very nature, whatever your goal is, it's almost always cumulative and incremental. I mean, that's just the way the system works. It's served us pretty well. We're in a time of great frustration now, but I'm not one that has any magic fixes. I think you have to show up every day and do your job. If you're an elected official, if you're going to be a candidate, you have to engage in real campaigns and real debate and be disciplined and serious about it. And by the way, that means going out and reaching out to people and getting in their communities and raising money and doing all the things that if you're going to be a real candidate, you have to do. There's no shortcuts. And most of the people I know in politics on both sides of the aisle, honestly, very well intentioned. And most of them are awfully nice people. I go to college campuses all the time, and I always ask this poll. I said, how many of you would vote for somebody that you don't disagree with, you know, I mean, you disagree with on a few things, but you think is an honorable person and whatever, and, you know, was trying to do the right thing. And then all the hands go up, you know, regardless of party. And I said, well, how many of you would vote for somebody you don't like? And nobody's hand goes up. Although this election, maybe a lot of hands are going up on both sides of the aisle. But the reality is, again, most politicians are pretty likable people. You know, they really are. But you have to sit down and be willing to engage in the hard work of governing and compromise.
And yet not everyone's convinced that the system is functioning perfectly smoothly at the moment. You've identified earmarks as one thing that we
Yeah, but I wouldn't make a constitutional amendment out of it. I mean,
but if we're going to make other incremental reforms, not at the constitutional level, or discard the Hastert rule or change something about the appropriations process.
Well, the Hastert rule is not a rule. I mean, any political leader on either side, I always ask people when they mention the Hastert rule, which is, you know, we won't bring up something that the majority is not in favor of. Tell me a time when Nancy Pelosi was Speaker for 4 years, she brought up a single bill that the majority of Democrats were opposed to. You won't find it. That's just normal. You know, leaders don't stay leaders very long if they make people vote on things that most of their followers disagree with. And that doesn't matter if you're on the left and you're right. So, again, I actually think that the biggest problems here now are a lack of a willingness to compromise, a sense that there are absolute victories rather than incremental progress to be made. There are times when you can do that. Democrats in 2009 and 2010 essentially had that ability for a fleeting moment, but it's not the norm. The norm is actually divided government over the last several decades. And that necessitates sitting down and saying, okay, where can we agree? What can we agree on? We set these aside. We're going to fight over these. But what can move down? The other big problem I see, and this is a problem that afflicts us more in the Republican Party right now, is while we have very little disagreement on the direction, we have profound disagreements over tactics. And some of our members have elevated tactical disagreements to theological disagreements. Look, I'm not a big fan of shutting down the government. I've never seen it work. This is just based on practical experience. You very seldom achieve an objective by making life worse for the American people. And it gets worse every single day the government is shut down. And it's expensive. You know, to reopen the government is actually very expensive. You never save any money. And you have to pay overtime to catch up on all the work. It's just true. So why would you use that tactic or threaten something that you can't do? That's a silly way to govern. And yet, I think partly sometimes because we have people that are so passionate about what they believe. There's nothing wrong with it. You ought to be passionate about what you believe. But you ought to choose the instruments and the tactics thoughtfully as to what's achievable. I actually think Democrats are better at this than Republicans because Republicans have a tendency to look for one-time solutions. I think Democrats see government much more as a process and much more as you get what you can get. Hey, we can do a little bit on early childhood education. We can do a little bit here on some other program that we want. And then the last thing I'd say is politicians on both sides, and actually I'll be tougher on my Democratic friends here, you don't deal with entitlement problems. And yet we've got two candidates for president, both of whom say we don't need to do anything on this. And entitlements, I haven't seen a single Democratic proposal that really deals with entitlement reform. You know, Paul Ryan's got a slew of them on Medicare, Medicaid. There's an easy fix, in my view, on Social Security. Not easy politically, but it's a math problem. It's not that hard to figure out what you need to do. And yet we're not talking about any of those things. So this ignoring of problems because electorally they're difficult is a big problem in our system right now on both sides.
So is this a self-correcting problem with government if Americans and their congressmen grow sufficiently disillusioned about the ability to enact their grand ideas, they'll start compromising again?
You know, I would say American voters are a lot like OU football fans. At University of Oklahoma, we'll fire you for going 8-4, not 4-8. American voters are like that, and they're in a firing mood right now. People that think change never comes up here, in terms of personnel, 60% of the Republican conference been elected since 2010. The electorate fired the Republicans from the House and the Senate in 06. They fired them from the presidency in 08. Everybody that I know on the Democratic side thought that, oh my gosh, we're going to be here now for the next generation. A sort of new New Deal coalition has emerged. 2010, Republicans fire the Democrats from the House. Then they turn around, reelect the president, but leave the Republicans to control the House. Then they fire the Democrats from the Senate in 14. There's a lot of personnel and movement and change going on. And by the way, we had that situation in the early 90s as well, in the 90 and 92 and 94 elections. Once people thought it was working, by 96, hey, the economy's doing pretty good. They got welfare reform. They're on a path to some sort of balanced budget. Guess what? We had stability in politics for about the next decade, really. Not much change in the House and the Senate in terms of numbers. So I think the American people will keep firing people until they get some combination that works. And it won't matter to them if it's Democrat and Republicans and, divide Democrats in charge here, Republicans. They just want it to work. Right now, they've had they've gone through the Great Recession. They've had a couple of unpopular wars. They're worth less. Their net worth is less than it was in 2007. And so they're not real happy. And I think, again, if the next president can actually get the economy grows faster, it looks like we're actually dealing with the long-term deficit. We find a way to make ourselves secure without deploying hundreds of thousands of people overseas, then you'll be rewarded. Absent that, you know, enjoy your brief tenure in office because there'll be somebody else coming soon.
So before I let you go here, I want you to imagine something for me. It's November 9th. You wake up, you walk down the drive, there's the paper, you unfurl it, and the headline reads.
It's my brother's birthday, is what it'll read, and it actually is. That's a good look. I'm not going to get in the prediction business. That's what we have elections about. Other than to say, I still think neither side can achieve a clean sweep kind of victory comparable to what the Democrats and the president achieved in 2008. So you better find members that know how to work together, and leaders better figure out how to fashion coalitions that can actually get something done. The next president, whoever it is, if they don't deal, for instance, with entitlements in the first couple of years, they're going to be running for re-election with a rising national deficit. That's just for certain. Deficit has come down from $1.4 trillion to this year was supposed to be around $450 billion. Now it's going back up because, again, baby boomers are retiring. Nothing's going to change that math. It'll take an American president, because you can't get entitlement reform without presidential leadership and parties willing to sit down and do something there. Tax, and we have opportunities. Look, there's a thirst for tax reform. That's a doable thing. There's a thirst for an infrastructure program. That's a doable thing. There's a necessity for an entitlement deal. You can do all those things in a massive deal, a reconciliation, a grand bargain.
But we may need to use a very small font on this headline.
Oh, small font?
Fit all this in.
Since I read the Oklahoman, it'll be Republican Sweep Oklahoma.
There you go. Congressman Tom Cole, thank you so much for being with us this morning.
Congressman Cole and Yoni, thank you very much. And thank you all for being here. And thank you to AFT for making this event possible. Please join us next week at the Washington Ideas Forum and for the next installment of We the People, where we'll hear from White House Senior Advisor Valerie Jarrett. And stay tuned for additional events in this series. So thank you all and have a great day. Take care.